Welcome to my presentation, thank you very much. So this paper is about lightweight fade verification across different poses for mobile platforms. This is a collaboration with a Spanish company, SqueezeFacePoseNet, which manufactures biometric identity solution for mobile devices. So this gives you an idea of why we are interested in mobile platforms. And this collaboration has been possible thank you to funding from the Swedish innovation agency, Bigun. So our motivation is regarding, comes from the use of mobiles, which today are data hubs with sensitive data. So it's critical to have authentication in real time and in an ubiquitous way. And biometric technologies can be a reliable method using sensors embedded in those devices. And the rapid development of convolutional neural networks has resulted in many accurate verification architectures, but the problem is that the popular architectures have hundreds of megabytes, which is infeasible for a mobile application. So our challenges are the use of a lightweight face recognition model of just a few megabytes with sufficient accuracy in comparison with larger models and able to operate under different poses, which is a type of natural variability found in mobile environments. So there are different techniques to reduce parameters and inference times in CNN. So one technique is the use of point-wise convolution, which involves the use of 1.1 filters with depth equal to the number of input channels. So in this example here, we have a depth of 3. So if we apply a filter of 1 times 1 times 3, we generate the output. If we apply, for example, 256 filters, we generate an output with 256 channels. So this example, we increase the number of channels from 3 to 256, but it could be the opposite, that we want to reduce the channels that we have at the input. Another technique is the twice separable convolution. That splits convolution into. So in regular convolution, for example, here, if we want to apply a 5 times 5 filter, we should have a filter of 5 times 5 times the number of channels of the input, 3 in this case. So if we want to generate an output of 256 channels, we would have to apply 256 of these filters. So this would result in nearly 20,000 parameters coming from all the different filters and more than 1.2 million multiplications to obtain this output signal here. So deep-wide separable convolution, what it makes is to divide convolution into. So it first apply a single filter per input channel. So here, if we have 3 input channels, we would apply 3 filters of 5 times 5. So this results in just 75 parameters and less than 5,000 multiplications, and to this output here, then we apply filters of 1 times 1. So if we want to get 256 channels here, we apply 256 channels of 1 times 1 times the number of input channels, that is 3 in this case. So if you make the computations, these two processes, so these two steps, results in less than 1,000 parameters for all the filters that are involved and just above 50,000 multiplications, which is just 4% of the regular convolution that I mentioned at the beginning. So the reduction of parameters is quite significant. The price that you pay in this case is that the accuracy is slightly reduced, but you speed up considerably the convolution, and the size of the model is significantly reduced as well. So based on these two techniques, there are more elaborated techniques or elaborated architectures that exploit these two techniques that I mentioned. So one is bottleneck layers, which is used by SqueezeNet CNN that I will mention later because this is the network that we have used. So this technique or this bottleneck layer technique, what it does is to reduce the input dimensionality just with 1 times 1 filters. And then, after we have reduced the dimensionality, we apply a large amount of filters. Here is represented by 8 filters. So here we reduce the dimensionality to 3. And then we apply, in this case, 8 filters, but of course it can be much more. And some of these filters are bigger, 3 times 3, which can also be deepwise separable for increased speed and a reduced number of parameters. So the concept is to reduce the number of channels and then apply a lot of filters to this input with reduced dimensionality. There is another technique called inverted residual layers, which is was presented in mobile net version 2, which is another famous CNN, and it's the same concept as above, but doing the opposite, taking an input with a reduced dimensionality that this dimensionality is increased by using 1x1 filters, and then to this increased dimensionality input we apply bigger filters of 3x3, which can be also deep wide separable filters for to reduce the number of parameters. And then to this output with high dimensionality, then we apply again 1x1 filters to get an output with reduced dimensionality again. So here is the opposite: increase dimensionality, apply bigger filters, reduce the dimensionality again. And here the authors of this network also add a shortcut or a residual connection between the input with reduced dimensionality and the output with reduced dimensionality as well. So the second technique involves more channels here, so much more filters here due to this increase in dimensionality. So as you see here, for example, the number of parameters and the size of this mobile net version 2 network is bigger still. These two architectures manage to keep a model with just a few million parameters and just a few megabytes in size, which is suitable for mobile applications. And there are specific CNNs presented to solve the problem of face recognition, most of them based on the architectures that I've mentioned before or in similar ones. So for example, Light CNN is an architecture based on residual connections. Mobile face nets or mobile face, there are two architectures which are based on mobile net 2, and they also incorporate other techniques, or they change some of the steps. For example, they don't use ReLU, but they use PreLU. And they also use global development convolution, which is a technique that I'll explain later that we have also implemented. And other networks like Shuffle FaceNet, which is based on ShuffleNet, which is another generic architecture, or CISO FaceNet, which is based on CISONet, which is another type of architecture. And you see here that these lightweight networks employ a smaller size in the input image. And the models, or the number of parameters, they are in the order of few megabytes, the model size, and few million parameters of the network. Regarding the network that we have evaluated in this paper, the network that we use is based on a SqueezeNet that I mentioned before, and we have called a SqueezeFacePoseNet to reflect the idea that we want to solve the problem of face recognition with pose variations. We have included to the original network two techniques. One is global development convolution that I mentioned here, that are present in some other works, and I will explain later. And deepwise separable convolution that I explained earlier, that is not present in the original network. And so you see here that we also keep a reduced input size. And the network that we have implemented are smaller than some of the others, or the majority of previous works related with lightweight face recognition. And we have used as baseline two networks based on ResNet 50 architecture, and these two networks are employed by the authors of the database that we have used here. So this is why we have used as a baseline with a network that employs input image with much bigger size and a model that, as you see here, has hundreds of megabytes and the dozens of millions of parameters. And of course, the inference time of this bigger model is one order of magnitude bigger than the other mobile architecture that are able to extract a feature vector with just in some dozens of milliseconds. So this is the basic architecture of the network that we have implemented. This is based on a SqueezeNet. So this architecture is basically the SqueezeNet generic CNN, with the main building block that is reduce and expansion block that, or procedure that I mentioned earlier. It used laydown sampling, reflecting in this max pooling layer. So the motivation given by the authors of this network is that by doing laydown sampling, the dimensionality of the outputs is keep as bigger as possible, and then it just reduce later in the processing, with the idea that this would produce bigger accuracy. And the modification that we have done is that we have reduced the input size of the network. The original network is 227, and we have reduced to 113. So with this, after To be able to reuse ImageNet training, we have changed the stride of the input layer from 2 in the original network to 1. So this convolutional layer here in the original network has a stride of 2, we have changed to 1. So this allows us to reduce the size of the input, the input image to half, and keeping the rest of the network equal to the original one, so we can reuse ImageNet training. And of course, we change the size of the fully connected layer at the output to the number of classes of our training database. And we have also incorporated a batch norm and dropout layer to prevent overfitting. We have also tried a couple of modifications that are not present in the original SqueezeNet. One is the use of deep Y separable convolution in 3x3 convolutions. So we want to assess the benefit of these steps. As you see here, by applying a deep Y convolution, the size of the model and the number of parameters is reduced substantially. And we have also incorporated global deep Y convolution instead of the regular global average pooling before the fully connected. So the global average pooling that is done by many networks is that in the last layer just before the fully connected, each channel, these elements here are just average to generate a single element here, and the same is done with all the channels here. So each channel, the elements are just average to generate the flattened vector that is fed to the fully connected part. In global development convolution instead, what we do is to train a convolution filter for each channel here. So here we would train 64 filters of 6x6, and with these filters we would generate the flattened vector here, but instead of just averaging these channels, we apply this convolutional filter. So as you can imagine, incorporating these filters here produces that the size of the model and the number of parameters is increased a little bit, but the authors of or the papers that incorporate this step, they suggest that if we have a phase here at the input, the regions of these channels here, they should not be just averaged, but they should be weighted in different ways to do phase recognition more accurate. So this is the justification or the motivation of the papers that incorporate this global deep waste convolution in phase recognition. So we have we wanted to test also this step. For our experiment, we have used two databases. We have used BGG phase 2 with more than 3 million images and 9,000 classes, with a training set defined by the authors of the database, or more than 3 million images and 8,061 classes. And they also have a test set with pose annotation, so we can carry out pose dependent experiments, recognition experiments. And this set has 368 classes with 10 images per pose, leading to 11,000 images. And for training, we have used the MS1M dataset, which also contains more than 3 million images of 35,000 different people. So these are some examples of these two databases. Here on the left, you have examples of BGG phase 2, of frontal images, three-quarter images, and profile images. And the same for MS1M. Here you have frontal images, three-quarter images, and profile images. We have pre-processed the image for training, as indicated. MS1M images are already cropped 113x113 in the release that we have used, so they are just used as provided, aligned already. And for BGG phase 2, the authors provide an extended bounding box, and they suggest that for training, you extract a random crop of the face, while for testing, you extract a crop around the center. So we have trained the networks for identification using softmax, and initialized with image net weights to accelerate convergence. We have used a GDM optimizer with a mini batch of 128, and the learning rate, as indicated that here, and decreased when the validation loss plateaus. We have divided the training set in 98% and 2% for validation to be able to identify when to reduce the learning rate. And we have used MATLAB as software, and the ResNet and Baseline models are run with matconf as provided by their authors. And the testing protocol for verification, we employ the image descriptor, as image descriptor, the vector before the fully connected layer, after the neighbors has been trained for identification. And these vectors have a dimensionality of 1000 with SqueezeNet and 2048 with the ResNet 50 baseline models. To generate a user template, we follow the protocol of the paper of the database. So we average m descriptors with the same pose. In the paper, they employ m equal to 5, but we have also tested m equal to 1, which is a more much more adverse case, where we just have one image to generate the user template. And to compute the scores between two templates, we use the chi-squared distance. And we have divided our experiments into different types. We have done same pose comparisons, where we just match images with the same pose, as shown here. And we have done cross-pose comparisons, where we match images with or templates with different poses, as shown in this example. Regarding results with the same pose, which are shown here, the first observation is that the plain network, the plain SqueezeFacePoseNet network, works the best in general. No global development convolution. If we incorporate global development convolution, the results are generally worse. Our interpretation is that since we have already cropped the images randomly for training here, the network is already able to learn that the faces are spatially translated here. So it can be counterproductive to train a convolution here to be able or to try to weight the regions differently, because the face at the input during training is not centered. So this is our interpretation, that we have not run training without random cropping, so we are not able to ensure, but this is our guess of why this happens. Regarding deep Y separable convolution, the performance is slightly worse. As I mentioned earlier, this is a suboptimal way of computing convolution, but remember that the model size is cut by 60%. So we have this trade-off of model size versus different accuracy. The two baseline models based on ResNet 50, they are of course better than our architecture, especially with one image per template. They are able to get comparatively good results. With 5 images per template, our model is already doing below 1% EER in insane post comparisons. And then remember that our network is 30 times smaller with 20 times less parameters. So we have this trade-off here of network size, but still we are very happy with the results that we are able to obtain here with our network, especially with 5 images. The EER is less than 0.54%, even in profile versus profile comparisons. And all nets, of course, made worse in this profile versus profile, but still, as I say, the EER is very good in this difficult case where the face is visible just from one side. Regarding cross-pose experiments shown here and here, the conclusions are more or less the same as before. Our network, the baseline one, works better in general than the other variations here. So no global development convolution. And with deepwise convolution, where we obtain a much smaller model, the performance is degraded as before. And the worst result is given with in the maximum variability case, which is frontal versus profile, this column here and this column here is where there is maximum variability between enrollment and test images. So this is the worst case. Still, with 5 images, the EER in this case is 0.14 with the baseline networks and 1.23% with our network, which could be related as decent in this very difficult situation. We could analyze many different things here, but I will skip for the sake of time. For example, we observe that frontal versus three-quarter is better than three-quarter versus profile. So in this case is here, frontal three-quarter. It's better than three-quarter versus profile, even if one could think that the relative difference in pose is the same between these two cases. and frontal versus frontal is more or less equal than frontal versus three-fourths, even if there is a variability in pose. So one possible interpretation is that the frontal face matters, at least in one template. Of course, this is just an initial conclusion, but we should analyze a little bit more, but we don't have time here. We have also evaluated the effect of the training database. Remember that we have two databases available with the same number of images, but the difference is that the number of images per person is different because one database has much more users than the other. So the hypothesis, and this is not our hypothesis, is the hypothesis of the authors of BGG Phase 2, is that if there is only one database to be used, use the one with more image per person, in this case the second one, because the network has to learn to separate more classes. The network has more images per class to separate, so this should be, it should lead to a better accuracy. And a better solution is that if we first train on the database with less images per person and then fine-tune on the database with more images per person. So here we have the results where we have done this fine-tuning, first training in one database, then fine-tuning in the other. This is what we have followed in so far in the paper. So this line here, this row here, reflects the results here, which is the protocol that we have followed so far, I have not mentioned. And in these two rows, we have the results with that network just trained with each of these two databases. So as you can see here, if we train with the database with less images per person, the results are worse than if we train with the database having more images per person. And the best solution, as we suppose, most of the times comes when we have trained with one database and then fine-tune with the other. So we have reached the conclusion. So our challenges was to carry out lightweight face recognition with a model of just a few megabytes with sufficient accuracy in comparison with much larger models and with cross-pose capability. So we have adapted a very light generic CNN, just a few megabytes to be used with small size face images. And we have trained this model with very large scale databases. And we have also tested some techniques. One technique to is stepwise convolution to further reduce the model size, and the cost is that the performance is also worse. And we have also tested global development convolution, that is regarded in some papers as a way of improving face recognition, but we have not observed improvements, maybe due to the random cropping in training that I mentioned. We have tested templates of 1 and 5 images per user, obviously 5 is better. And we have benchmarked our network against a baseline model much bigger in size and in parameters. So we don't outperform this baseline model, but we still get, we believe, meritorious results. And even under severe post variations, we get a good EER, 1.23% in frontal versus profile, or 0.54 in profile versus profile. As future work, we plan to evaluate performance versus number of images per template. Of course, you don't necessarily have the same number of images in the enrollment and on test templates, so varying these numbers in a different way is also a future direction, and mixing different poses in the same template that we have not tried here. And at the architecture level, there are different techniques that our network SqueezeFacePoseNet doesn't incorporate, like residuals, inverted residuals, or reactivation of layers, different techniques proposed out there to increase the performance. And we are also working in the use of perioccular region, which has gained popularity during the last year for obvious reasons. So this is the end of my presentation. Thank you very much for your attention.